And so we see this very insidious change happen in Christianity that was thousands of years ago, but we still haven't fully recuperated from what that did to our message. And we can look at our own history as Anabaptists, our Mennonite history. Around 1525, we have this rebaptism where some of our ancient, it's about 400 years ago, people were rebaptized and they broke from the state religion of their day. And then they faced a very, very clear opposition. They were killed for their cause. They were martyred. They said, if you are rebaptized, if you preach as an Anabaptist preaching, if you're an Anabaptist yourself, you will be killed. And there's, you want to look at some gruesome tales, look at the martyrs' meeting. Martyrs' meeting is filled with stories of people being killed for their faith. But then the same thing happened. We escaped this persecution. We went to different parts of the world. And all of a sudden, the change started to take place. In the same way that the early Christianity was incorporated into the Roman Empire, our Anabaptist, our Mennonite faith, was kind of incorporated into the broader world as a whole. They said, okay, now it's our right. We're not going to persecute you anymore. And I'm not saying persecution is good, but in the same way, our message was changed. We didn't have this opposition. And one of the things I'm getting at here is an identity. An opposition gives us a very clear identity. You're forced to know who you are if there's someone telling you, you can't be this. You have to make that decision. Whereas today we have the luxury of sitting around thinking about different things, examining different things. There's no one forcing us to think one way or another. And there's no one opposing whatever decision we make. It may be this or that. There's no one opposing any decision that we make. And so our identity, it's muddy. We're a little unsure of who we are. Without a clear adversary, our identity is not clearly marked. And one of the things I begin to see within Christianity is, as a result of this, is there's a change in the direction of the flow. And what I mean by this is within Christianity, for all of us followers of Christ, the flow should be from Christ to the world. From what we read in the scriptures, what we know in our personal relationship with Christ, we should take that out into the world and be changing the world. We should say, this is what we believe, this is who we are, this is what I've learned in the scriptures, this is what I've learned from my church, and this is what I'm going to take to the world. Whereas now, I see the flow beginning to change, where we have the world, we have different things affecting us. It could be TV, how many hours of TV you watch, how many hours are on the internet, or different radio that you listen to. No matter what it is, the world has its influence on us. And now the flow is beginning to change, where we take this influence that we're experiencing in the world, and we're taking that back to the Bible. We're taking that back to our church. We're taking that back to our Christian walk. We're saying, we're letting this affect us. Instead of us being steadfast in our foundation and going out into the world and letting us affect the world, there's a change in the flow. And it's really damaging the Christian message. And so our identity has been changed by this insidious nature of life. Let's move on to the end of the text. So the men, the disciples, are in front of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin is very upset with Peter's response that they must obey God rather than men, because he's inferring that these men that are religious leaders are not followers of God. Very upset, and they wanted to kill him. And then we have this voice of wisdom to speak up. I'm not exactly sure how to pronounce his name, but I think it's Gamaliel. And we've heard this name before. This was the same person that was the tutor to Paul, earlier Saul. So Saul, we know, he says earlier, I was a Pharisee of Pharisees, he was trained. This is the person that Saul trained under. So he has a big influence in the scriptures because Paul knew his Old Testament inside and out because he learned from this man. And we can see that he was respected by everyone. He was a Pharisee. Now this is a meeting that the Pharisees and the Sadducees, these two groups did not respect each other at all. They were at odds, but they sat together at the Sanhedrin and they tried to make decisions. And so we can see he had a lot of respect because when he spoke, everyone listened. The Sadducees listened, and the Pharisees listened. Usually, they didn't listen to each other. But when this man stood up and spoke, everyone listened. We have this wisdom in verse 38, where he starts speaking. He says, everyone, this is him speaking, leave these men alone. Let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. If it's of human origin, it will fail. But if it's from God, it will continue and you'll find yourself fighting against God. And I read this text, I think this gives me a relief. This eases a lot of tension for me as a Christian. A lot of times we feel this pressure, and maybe I feel it more as a pastor of a church, but we feel the pressure that we're responsible to make the church grow, or to sustain the church, or to make the church what it is. We have to maintain the different things. We have to maintain programs, or we have to maintain a youth program, or we have to be inviting new people in, or we have to be doing all these things. We feel this pressure that can build upon anyone, really. And we have to do this as a Christian. We have to do these certain things. And the list would go on of all the different responsibilities that we give ourselves. But really, if we look at this idea, our task is simply to pray to God and see where God is moving. We need to pray to God and see where God is moving. Because where God is moving, what God is starting, what God is maintaining, that will be a success. It will be successful. If God is not there, it will not be successful. It's pretty simple. If God is there, it will be success. And we need to pray and see where God is moving. We need to pray that the Holy Spirit would guide us as we discern where we want to invest our time and energy. Is this a place where God is moving? And how can we be a part of the movement of God? Is this what God wants us to be doing or not doing? Because if God is leading, it will be a success. So I think when we look at all these things, when we look at the insidious changes that have been happening, we look at the lack of opposition and all these different things, I don't think that's a good starting point. We don't need to look for opposition to define us. We don't need to say, okay, we need something to persecute us or someone to persecute us, then that'll help our identity. We don't need that. And we don't need to become more strict. We don't need to become more legalistic to combat these changes that are happening. We don't need to put down more and more rules, because more rules will have a better church. No, we don't need to revert to that. We simply need to pray and find out where God is moving and be a part of this movement and be a part of the purpose and be a part of the activity that God is doing. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the promises you've given us in Scripture. We thank you for these stories that you've given us of your disciples moving early on after you died and were resurrected. And Lord, we pray that we can learn from this. We pray that we can learn from the passion that they had to take a stand for you. And Lord, oftentimes we look for that and we'd like to take a stand as well. But Lord, we pray that you would lead and guide us. Because we know you are moving. We know that the times have changed in 2,000 years, but you are still here. You are still among us. And we pray that your Spirit would lead and guide us as we discern how to be Christians, how to be a church in the society that we live in. We pray this all in Jesus' name.